also. And in his name means that Jesus is still doing the same works that he did, but he's doing them through me and his body. So it's a wide range of areas that we need to begin to focus on in order for us to even be in the game in terms of enjoying our rights, our share of the rights and privileges that God has given us. So I put it down in this way, and I want to challenge you to really begin to focus in the areas that Christ has actually provided all of these benefits for. I mean, his atonement covers a wide range of blessings. And I think that we need to try to find out as much as we can about what we have, what our rights and privileges are. Amen. And I think that when we find out, then we need to really begin to hook up with the Word and begin to affirm them and begin to speak those things and call the things that be not as though they are. And I know we have to do, but that's the first step of faith. That's the first action that we take when we are born again. After we are born again, saved through the Holy Spirit, then from that point, we need to begin to find out every provision, every promise, every blessing, every redemptive right, and begin to affirm that, begin to speak it, and begin to praise God for it. Mm-hmm. And whatever we have to do in addition, then that we are to do as well. If it's in the area of blessing, financial blessings, we know what tithing is and what has to come into play. Mm-hmm. You're right? Uh-uh. Giving has to come into play. And also in all of these provisions, acting in love, carrying out the commission, whatever, the ministry of reconciliation, is always going to involve keeping yourself in the love of God. I mean, there are some works that you just have to do in order for, like Jesus came that we might have what life and have what life more abundantly. You don't realize how valuable it is, how important it is for you to reach out to people, to minister, to be consistently involved in doing the works that Jesus did, and blessing and helping people, and actually doing all that we can to build them up. That's very, very important. I think that each one of you can attest to the fact that, like this morning, I had done my meditation, then I said, well, my meditation is good. It was about 2 hours in meditation. And I said, I feel good personally. I feel good. I felt like running, jumping over a wall and running through troops. I just felt real motivated. I said, well, I need to divert this joy and enthusiasm to reaching out to somebody. So I called about 3 or 4 people that I normally connect with during the week and just start talking to them. And so that's the thing that brings the fullness of joy and the thing that enables God's promises to come into fruition. You have to add to your faith, the things that will cause you to be full, experience the fullness of joy, and God works through life. The more life you have, the more God can bring to pass in your life. So that's the reason why we want to continue to speak and to call the things that be not as though they are. Because when I speak, God began to show me things. I mean, you get revelation of the things that you are trying to believe for, how to go about bringing it to pass. You begin to see people God will place in your path to help you to bring the promise to pass. I mean, God will just, the Bible says, shine light on your pathway when you begin to release words affirming the things that he has already blessed you with. All right, I'm done. Okay, let me see, where am I passing it? Okay, what do you have that I'm passing it?
Faith process, expanding your capability to believe.
Okay, I want y'all to, we're not going to teach on this tonight, but this is something that we need to be refreshed on. And maybe y'all already have it in your folder. If you have it in your folder, I need to take this out. All right, if you want to be a spiritual giant in 6 months or a year, compared to what you are now, read this real good. Read this real good, and it will tell you how to get there. What's it called? A God Kind of Faith. Everybody got this? This is dealing mainly with confession, meditation, and its relationship to faith. It brings it down where you can really understand it. All right, now in addition to that, last week I mentioned...
Can we have more than one pastor?
Oh, sure. Okay, how many remember the path to spiritual breakthrough? And we mentioned that we were going to give special recognition to people that read these, how to build the highest type of faith. Let me see what pages. We're going to let them come before the people and show them the results of affirming the word on a consistent basis. All right. That's page 88 through 127. But anyway, the areas of the integrity of the word, these are things that we really want to really begin to look at. Can we trust God's word? Is God's word forever settled in heaven? The Bible says the counsels, his counsels of old are faithful, yes, and true. And there hasn't failed one word of all of his good promises. But we want to begin to speak, affirm that God will always, every case, he will stand by his word. So whatever we speak, you know, it can't go no other way than what God says. The integrity of the word. I mean, this will build your faith a whole lot more than you think it will if you would just focus on what God says about his word. All right, then our release from Satan's power. Amen. We want to not only know it in terms of the head knowledge, but we want to know that we are truly released. That's the reason why I pass you out. Did I pass you out the righteousness handout? I haven't done that yet.
You just have one.
Okay, here's the second one, righteousness. Okay, when a person is righteous and they know it beyond a shadow of a doubt, they will always be bold and confident and have a dominant spirit. They actually become an overcomer the moment that they recognize that Satan's power and authority over their life has come to an halt. Satan is defeated. He's no longer able to rule and to control me in any area of my life. So our release from Satan's power. Now these are things that you want to focus on if you really want to be bold and confident in winning souls, building people up, operating in whatever ministry that God has given you to operate in. The Bible says a righteous man is as bold as a what?
Lion.
Bold as a lion. All right, so those are areas that you really want to focus on. And I'm going to offer some kind of special recognition to people that would go over these repeatedly. I might want to challenge somebody to do all of these at least once per week.
All of these what?
These areas, okay? Building the highest type of faith.
Oh.
Go over, because I think it's time for us to realize how much power and authority that we have as believers, and what our potentials are. Our potentials are unlimited. So you have to really begin to feed the word, and believe me, as you feed the word, it will begin to penetrate and impregnate your spirit. It's going to have an effect on how you believe, how you see things, and how you see yourself. It's a slow process, but the word of God will never return void. You have to speak the word until it makes that impression. It connects with your spirit being and produce the life that will cause it to manifest in the area that you are speaking. Okay, so the life, ability, and fullness received. You already have one. Jesus said that what? He came that we might have what? Life.
Life.
And life what? More.
Abundantly.
Amen. So we're going to talk about a little bit of that tonight in the righteousness.
Question over here.
Mm-hmm.
Is it that we know that we have life? Is the challenge that we don't know how to appropriate it? I was thinking Sunday before last, Brother Williams challenged us in Sunday school. He asked a question. You remember that question you asked?
I didn't get an offering, so I don't know.
No, what was it? About, you know, the Word of God, is there something to the effect that believing the Word of God, is there a part that believers have to pay?
Yeah.
Do you remember that question?
When you're praying, you want a miracle, you want God to move for you, what's the human side of it? What is it that God wants you to do or told you to do?
Yeah.
Have you done the human side first, and then God would go ahead and do what he...
And can you receive his promises? I'm getting back to appropriating it.
Mm-hmm.
Can you receive the promises of God without doing the human side?
Yeah.
Okay, well, you're kind of getting me off my point. All these questions are good, but the mainest thing is that before you begin to act in faith, you need to affirm God's word.
Yeah.
And boldly,
yeah.
Confidently, mm-hmm. Not just one time. It needs to be what? A consistent thing.
Yeah.
This is a way of life for believers.
Mm-hmm.
Because Jesus is the high priest of our confession, right?
Right.
If we don't give him anything to work with, then what? He just sits there waiting for what? You to say something.
This is that.
And you only can use words to bring the past. Your words to bring the past is promised. That's the only way you can bring. So that's the first step, of first action, and all of the others will follow, because that action will begin to what? Cause you to get what? Creative ideals, and God will begin to what? Cause a lot of things to happen, people to cross your path. But you got to start it with
right.
What? Affirming the word.
I didn't mean to get ahead of you.
Mm-hmm.
Go on.
But this is the reason why I'm asking you, in every area of blessings promised, in every area of blessing promised, we need to affirm. As much as we know, we are to affirm that. Okay, so that's the reason why I have all of these different areas down here. So there's just too many. Well, let's just see if we can do without any of them. Our release on Satan's power, can we do without that?
No.
All right. The life, ability, and fullness that we have received. All right, can we just make that obsolete? You don't want the life, you don't want the ability that Jesus and the fullness that we have been given, you don't need that?
Yeah, we need it.
Okay, but that fullness and that life and the ability, it begins to what? Manifest as we begin to what? Affirm things. It'll make you happy. I feel like running all over this place. I feel like running over. Amen. I feel like leaping over a wall right now. I feel like I could jump on that table. So what's that? I could try. But the way that that joy manifests is that it motivates me, stirs me to reach out to people on a daily basis. And that's when I came, I said, I would love to have a hand in doing whatever I could to provide them with a good, solid, strong spiritual foundation. And I said, besides that, we have some excellent team teachers here too. And he was very, very, very interested in that. So I called him this morning, and he did say that he was going to try to make the Bible study, and even if he was interested in prayer. But the main motivation that I had was that I would like to see those young men, because they seem to be very disciplined. He's been working with them. They were so memorable, and they talked, they had so much respect. And so I'm thinking that this church could be a channel that those kind of people can flow in. And that's one of the reasons why I'm trying to get us at a level where we can really help people. And I know that in order to be able to help people, you have to be really devoted to the Word. We have to really use the Word as our battle axe. Everything Jesus did, he used the what? He used the Word. So that is the reason why I'm so persistent about hearing words that will build you, that will establish you, that will impact people, that will cause you to have the anointing that you need in order to make the impact on people, and that it will come as a result of you consistently, what, speaking out and calling the things that be not. In every area that God has made provisions for you, I guarantee you, you need to be what? Affirming that. Man. You need that. You need it. Amen. Now this morning, I just took it on myself just to call four people, and Brother Carlos was one of them, because, you know, we need to, you know, we work together usually 2 or 3 times a week. We connect. He comes on Wednesday night. And sometimes he comes on Saturday. But we have also got several brothers to connect with. Well, at least one or two has connected with him. Two.
Yeah.
And they're constantly what? Feeding, encouraging, befriending him.
It's awesome.
And this is the type of motivation that we want to engender, you know, in the ministry. And I was really inspired with Sister Mary Ann Alexander. Okay, last Wednesday night, she said that Kim Brown and her have teamed up. Why don't you just tell them what you...
I don't know. She's just special. I was telling Sister, we've never done anything together, we've never been anywhere together, but I just... love Sister Kim. I love everybody, but she just loves Sister Kim. And so I had told her a couple of Sundays ago, it's like, now look, this year I want to do something different. I travel a lot, but I'm out of town a lot. But sometimes I'm in the bed too. Okay? So I just asked her, I said, now if you don't see me, I want you to call me. And if I don't see you, I want you to call me. And let's keep up with each other this year.
She was here last Wednesday night. You know, I don't know, Pastor Hill probably couldn't accomplish that. But they did, she did. And that is awesome. Sister Kim, are you here tonight? Not against your will. But what we said Monday night, we did say that we would like for everybody that really want to obey the Word of God, we want you to begin sowing some kind of way into somebody's life on a weekly basis. I'm not saying a daily basis, but a what? A weekly basis. That is the reason why some say, well, I don't have anything to say. I don't know what to say. But that's the reason why we have these books here. And we don't want you to just get on there and talk and, you know, and gossip and just give them a good confession. How many believe a good confession will help somebody along their way that week? And one confession that really blessed me last week, Brother Travis gave it to us, was Monday night. It was the confession. See, I almost had it. See, Brother Travis brought it up. I had almost forgotten it. My mind wasn't even on this confession, but it says financial faith confession. And it almost, it just loaded down. I don't know if anybody in our membership or anybody that we are connected with and that we rub shoulders with on a daily basis wouldn't benefit by a financial faith confession. I believe if it would give you 5 minutes or 10 minutes for you to read it to them. All right. How many believe that?
Amen.
All right. Well, I sure am tempted to read it, but ooh. Money comes to me, my nature attracts money. The fear of lack has been broken and has no power over me. I hear my father's voice and the voice of intimidation and limitations I choose not to follow. I am free from debt. I am the lender and not the borrower.
Yes.
All right, so in addition to page 4 regarding finances, we have page 5, the prosperity confession. All right, this prosperity confession would be really great to share with somebody that's having problems or struggling with finances. Anybody know anybody that might be having a challenge with finances?
Amen.
How many are satisfied with the flow of finances coming to the office? How many, come on, let's read all in there. How many are satisfied? How many are pleased? Nobody pleased? Anyway, this ought to be the number one confession. Brother Travis, you shouldn't be able to hold them back over there. They should be walking up. Well, we were thinking, Brother Travis and I talked, we were thinking that maybe we should start meeting in the auditorium.
Yeah.
And let people spread out all over the auditorium.
Amen.
And let them read these confessions for about 30 minutes.
Amen. Amen. Get them down in the spirit.
Yeah. That's what we're thinking that we're going to start doing, because we believe that this would produce the highest kind of faith if people could learn how to do that on a consistent basis. And we have to kind of get you in practice and start and let you in that direction. And if we keep meeting down here, everybody's scared to say anything. Well, you can hear it because we think we're going to disturb your sister here. We were sitting together over here Monday night. And I started making confession, and I started praying kind of loud. She said, tone it down.
That's not what I said.
I mean, like that.
I said, you're disturbing me.
See what I tell you? See what I'm saying? See what I'm saying?
Well, that was...
So I think that we ought to have everybody... We got, how many pews do we have? We got about 32 pews. We don't have over 30 people coming. So we give everybody a pew, and you just let your head, you can just go all out. You can pray in the spirit as loud as you want to, but we want you to, what, agree with God. I mean, say something that makes a difference.
Yes.
Say something. You know, I feel like, you know, we have a tremendous opportunity. If we're going to meet on the fourth Saturday and really spend 4 hours here, wouldn't it be sad if we just ignore all of these?
Ooh, God,
yeah. We ought to be reading these books through several times a week in order for us to be what? Full of the word, full of light.
That's good.
Full of the anointing. And when we show up, I mean, you don't have to be struggling and going through all these changes. You'll break almost immediately. You probably start singing in the spirit when you first few minutes. So this is the way I feel like I remember years ago that we used to practice this, and when we brought people together in prayer, after 30 minutes of affirming the word, somebody will be on our release from Satan's power. Somebody might be doing the life ability and fullness that we have received. I'm made an able minister and co-laborer. All of these are scriptures that we can affirm, and we can get a whole lot of life, enjoy a whole lot of life. How many know there's life in the Word? There's life in the Word. And it will get into your spirit if you begin to affirm and hook up with what God said. You have to hear yourself.
Yes.
Amen. How many can say amen?
Amen.
Okay, so these are the areas, and somebody might say, all of these different areas, our right standing with God, that's righteousness, and I just raised that out. Mm-hmm. So Denise is going to help us in that, but the righteousness teaching, we're going to just take our time and do it, the power of the believer, the authority of the believer, we're going to do that. But we want to really begin to focus on affirming. The confession pamphlet I pass out tonight will assist you and show you the importance of what you say. Mm-hmm. We're trying to build the highest kind of faith. We want to get out of this spiritual deadness, this trap that Satan has laid for us with all of this word, with all of the teaching. Amen. And many times on Sunday morning, it seems like we look at the praise team like a calf look at a new gate. We just look at, oh, isn't that wonderful? Isn't that wonderful? We just look at them. You know, and we could be full of life. And if we were anointed and full of life, my Lord, what could God do? You have a praise and worship.
Amen.
Amen. So, all of these are areas that you could be meditating on during the week to build yourself up. How many know what I'm talking about now? These are areas down pages 88 through 125, wherever. The grace and love of God, our authority as overcomers, God's goodness and mercies, prosperity, wealth, and riches, the reality of the Father's indwelling. All of these carry a series of scriptures. The authority and power of the name of Jesus. The sacrifice of praise. All of these, and some of you might wonder, why you have so many? Why couldn't we just work on just one? That means a lot of stuff. Let's just work on one area that God has blessed us in. Not all of these. But, you know, I don't expect everybody to go through all of these. But it still remains that every provision and every blessing that God has provided through his redemption, amen, those of his outer responsibility to affirm. If you don't affirm them, that means that those benefits more than likely will not become manifesting in your life. So how many want to miss a blessing? So therefore, now let me bring this to past. Let me bring this to the service too. Now, Sister Hill, and we got Sister Marianne, we got several people that read the Bible through every year. Right, I read the Bible. Sometimes I don't like to read it, the whole thing, because I don't like to read all of the genealogies. The numbers, those statistics, I don't like to read all of them. So I stick more or less with the New Testament, and whenever a story is quickened in my spirit, I go back and go over that story of David, the story of Joseph, and all of that. But most of my time I spend in specific areas of the Word of God that I want God to manifest himself to me. This is actually how I came about all of this, all of these confessions and all of these books. Because every morning, I did this for several years, at 4, 5 o'clock, and usually I was up at 3 o'clock, and God would just tell me, Amen. He said, everything that I have shown you and quickened to you and that have helped you all of these years, you know, we've had about three different generations of people to come through this ministry. Go way back in the 70s. I remember his bishop, Butler. When he went to Raymond, I remember him visiting this church.
I was 70.
So we've even, let me name some more. Carlton Pearson, his parents. Name some more. There were many.
Miles Monroe.
Yeah, Miles Monroe. Miles Monroe came here in the 70s, and he did Seven Dimensions of Praise. I never will forget. Seven Dimensions of Praise. And that was so powerful. And, you know, a lot of these noted evangelists, musicians have come through this ministry. We've produced, you know, three or four generations of people that's all over the place. Now, we are here now. We're trying to make it with this generation. We're trying to, you know, the church has been filled to capacity, in some instances, almost, you know, in every generation. But, we want to make this the best generation. Amen. How many believe we can make this the best of all?
Amen.
All right. So we want to get back. We want to get back to, you know, the fasting. David Mitchell said that this fasting thing needs to be restored.
Absolutely.
Amen. How many know that? Rather than eating fast, we need to what? Start fasting. And what we're going to do, we're going to have this consecration, Sister Jenny, so powerful. But I'm trying to put all the ducks in a row before we announce our consecration. I want the singers, you know, we got song after song that's designed to break into our brokenness, to pull out the anointing, the medley that will actually bring God on the scene big, big time. I mean, we got a lot of these songs already in the making that we have already, the typist put them all together, and there's several on each sheet, and we're going to have about 17 sheets already. But these are songs that we have used throughout our church history. Mm-hmm. That have been noted for bringing brokenness. The hymns, the Hosanna songs, they're songs that's very, very stirring, very touching. And we believe that if we can sing these songs, and we want to put copies of all of these words into the hands of all members. Yes. Because we don't want the praise team just singing to us all the time, and we just weren't looking at them. Mm-hmm. Oh, that ain't fair, is it? You need somebody to sing to you someday, right? All right. I mean, how do y'all think this is, how this works? We're supposed to sing every Sunday, and we just really enjoy it, and, you know. And I want to get back to dancing.
Amen.
Miles Monroe, that was his teaching. He said that's the seven levels of praise, that you got to do something to bring all three components, your mind, spirit, and what? Body.
Body.
Together in unity, where they all begin to cooperate together.
Hallelujah.
And he says that there are certain things you have to do that. And after they come together, amen, and you, they're coordinated, and the Spirit begins to work, you know, then you can pray in the Spirit, you can sing in the Spirit, and then he said what? The Hallel, you got to what?
Yeah.
Amen, dance sometime.
Yeah.
You got to get all of this praise operating in your life. The dance back. How many believe we can get the dance
Amen.
Back?
Got the dance.
God has not given us the spirit of fear. Some of y'all remember that old song. But we got a lot of songs like that on the list because they're designed to what? To get you back to where you need to be. Now we have all these songs. Wait a minute, y'all. We have all of these songs and all of these confessions going on at the same time. I mean, you know, same period of time.
Yeah.
Amen. Amen. Get up in the morning and start what? Reading these.
Yeah.
Speaking them out. Speaking to Brother Al. He needs to hear it. And she needs to hear it too. I mean,
We want more life in this place, right? We want more anointing. Because it's taste of what? Anointing to what? Do what God needs to do. Everybody needs to what? Prepare themselves. And I'm just racing and trying to do everything I can before that fourth Saturday. Because I don't want everybody to come. I mean, a lot of us to come in that 4-hour prayer meeting dry. Y'all know what I mean? Coming in just dry as a what? Dry as a what?
Bone.
Dry as a bone.
Bone.
Okay.
Bone.
Now suppose, but praise team, we've already talked about it. All of the songs that we want to release into the body, all of the songs that will cause brokenness, someone will cause you to dance, we're going to release these, and the praise team, and we have individual singers that can do medleys, maybe do 4 or 5 songs. We can record that on a CD. We're not selling this, but we want to put a copy of these songs into every member's hand so they can sing these, learn how to sing. We're trying to get more life in this place.
Yeah.
It bothers me. On Sunday, you have people that look so dry and sad and, discouraged and frustrated. And sometimes, you know, it really bothers me. And then, when you look at the offering and the tithe,
I'm sorry.
Overall, we have some real, real devoted, super devoted tithers and givers in this church. Very devoted. But there are some you kind of get discouraged over. And I really have, you know, I don't even look at it. I don't look at the Sister Hill. She's the one, she knows all, she keeps up with everything. She tells me about it. She just tells me so much, but I don't like to look at those figures. Pastor Hill, pastoral offering, 0. This sister here, gave an offering the other day. I just couldn't believe it. I feel like giving it back to her. but we got faith among people that are, you know, maybe one parent families. But we do have solid givers. But yes, as David was saying the other day, I mean, Sunday, he was making the case that I don't care how strong the leader is, he was talking about Sister Deborah, but when people come, they are not in the flow of what she's doing, it really kind of pulls away, takes away that what? That motivation, that zeal, that fervor, that anointing. And sometimes, you know, the lack of proper response, people falling short. And, you know, I look at it this way. I feel like tithing should, I mean, everybody ought to get that resolved in the first 3 months. 3 months. That's the ABCs of your salvation. That's the primary thing. You should learn how to what? Trust God, amen, and what? Take him at his word and understand that what the tenth part of every dollar is what? Is God. And when you see people haven't learned that in 10 years, it's very frustrating.
You know, Pastor, one of the things that I learned is, and it's something that we talked about, What is the spirit behind what it is you do? I mean, one time I put my tithes and offering in, and the guy said, I don't need your money. I mean, I just got so routine, and I'm giving this and that, and it wasn't worship, I wasn't excited, it was just something I was doing, you know what I'm saying? And so I think what we've been talking about in terms of our attitude, in terms of, and then I had to take a hard look at myself and say, okay, I ain't been in my word like I should be. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? I am going to church on Wednesday and Sunday, but that's part of the routine, like getting up, taking a shower, you know what I'm saying? So that spirit coming back into the church, mm-hmm. coming back to us, mm-hmm. I think in everything that we do, like you said, you know, I get excited about giving an offering now. You know?
So again, you get a what?
Excited. I get excited about giving an offering.
Sure.
All right. I get more excited about giving the offering than I do when I give.
Wow. But we really appreciate those of you that have a heart of giving. We really appreciate that. And I'm going to tell you like it is. If some of us hadn't been hearing from God and so responsive in giving on a consistent basis, it would be beyond me. I wouldn't be able to do what I do. But it's just when I see the faith of the faithful, those that are really committed to this ministry. You know, it's the same ones in Monday night prayer, Wednesday night Bible study. They're the ones that makes making everything else go. You know, some of them are here Monday night, Tuesday night, Wednesday night in succession. But this is the challenge that we all have. But we're going to be fasting and praying. But we want to bring all of these components into play when we do have a consecration. Because I believe if we have all of these components in place, you start building up yourself now on your most holy faith by praying in the Holy Ghost. You know, that's another area that will be enhanced tremendously as you begin to read these confessions out loud. I mean, that will enable you to flow much better in the Spirit for a prolonged period of time. And even it will give you that motivation to press in the Spirit. You get to a point in the Spirit where you can You know, come up against a brick wall. You can just pray, and break through.
Yeah.
And just elevate your voice sometimes and do some Shabbat. Begin to shout the word out. Shout it out. And at some point, you're going to get a what? You're going to get that breakthrough. You're going to experience the brokenness that will usher in the presence of God. And we believe that praying in the Spirit is important, but we do believe that affirming the word is most important. Affirming the word. If we come into a prayer meeting and we are not building the word by saying, agreeing with God, it's just so much you're going to experience in prayer. You get to a certain point and what? Everything goes dead. All right. Now, how many believe the singing would help if you're consistently singing songs that's full of the word? Mm-hmm. And we chose songs that all centered around the redemptive work of Christ. Mm-hmm. The redemptive work of Christ. Amen. Praise God.
Amen.
So how many believe that when we can bring it all together and then begin to go through a consecration, maybe 2 weeks or 3 weeks or whatever, I believe that God will honor that, and I believe that the results would be staggering. I believe that God will begin to do some new things. All right, how many can say amen?
Amen.
All right, so back to this. We still want you to do your meditations in as many areas as you possibly can. The prosperity area is important. And I'm speaking about this book here. Page what, 75? Oh, 88. What did I start?
88.
Okay, 88. Okay, 88 through what? The rest of the book. 88. All right. Praise God. How many on board now? How many on board?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. All right. Everybody got this information? Okay. It's two-sided. Page 126. Everybody got the information? Everybody got the material? Everybody have this book here? And it goes up to 126?
Mine is.
You have one side.
If you got one side of it and it's that small, you have the wrong one. Okay, it's supposed to be.
You want the right one, don't you?
Yeah, that's two sides.
But yours is one sided. Switch it up with one, another one you have back here. You have one more with you?
Yeah, he was one here, so he's one here.
That doesn't tell us.
When we first produced those, it only went to page 36.
Okay. Thank you.
All right, everybody, okay, everybody got a book? Okay, now, it's important now, even for leaders, leaders. If leaders are not promoting things that the pastor is promoting, if leaders are not promoting this, if the leaders feel like it's not important, then the people that you are teaching are going to pick up the same attitude. So we all have to what? Be aware that this body needs to what? Be affirming the word. We need to get back. And I chose the area of the word that all of our redemption applies to. The area of our redemption, Christ's death, burial, and resurrection. All of these confessions are centered around our redemption, what Christ has done, who we are. So we want to, now if you really want to begin to minister to others, all you have to do, use any part of these areas in either book. You might want to start with the first four pages in the prayer book. If you are ministering to new people, see here, the prayer book. This is very simple. The first four pages, four or five pages, would be suitable for almost anybody. Okay, Sister Mary.
I gave my book to someone who was ill, so I need to get another one of those.
Okay. All right, I got a whole box full of them here.
Oh, good.
Okay. Now, these are on page, this is the righteousness of God. And Sister Denise, I'm not going to put on the spot tonight, but we want you to get ready. But I want you to look through this. I'm not sure how much time we have left, because I wanted to address the consecration that we are preparing for and how you can begin to prepare. And this is an overview of the righteousness of God and the problems that we face. We started out with the problems that sin consciousness presents. And we have 1, 2, 3, 4 points. Now listen to number 4, page 27. Many Christians have struggled for years with repeated sin, habits, hang-ups, and severe problems in their character. They have sought diligently for solutions to their various forms of spiritual failures and frustrations, which could help them to live a righteous and overcoming life, but have convinced themselves that they cannot because of their defeats, failures, weaknesses, and inabilities. They have done many good deeds in an effort to silence their conscience. They have prayed and fasted. They have agonized in prayer. They have repented of sins, confessed sins to others. They fought bad habits, made sacrifices for the Lord, gave up pleasures, gave money, and worked in the church. After doing it all, many are still experiencing defeat at the hands of some unseen enemy. Victory seemingly promised us still eludes us. We still struggle with sin consciousness. And that is the reason why the message of righteousness has to be taught over, 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 over. That's the reason why these confessions are so important, because we have a lot to overcome, because a lot of these negative traits and a negative way of believing have been what instilled with us in us from way, way, way back. And you just don't walk away from it because you're saving the Holy Spirit. Okay, so therefore, I believe that the approach that we're going to be using, singing the word, getting the word, everybody likes to sing. Don't we, Brother William? All right, everybody likes to sing. I know I love to sing. But singing the word, especially if it's based on what?
Scripture.
In the word.
It's new creation realities. Yeah. The word is very powerful. Very powerful. All right. All right, but if you don't like to sing, then what? You declare it. You affirm it. You confess it. And then you act on the words that you confess. Follow through and do whatever else God tells you to do. All right, let me read verse 5. We don't have time to read all of this. At the root of all spiritual failures is sin consciousness. It is the sorrow from where our inabilities, weaknesses, fears, and insecurities grow. Man has become stigmatized by this blighting curse, and for ages has caused him to feel substandard and subhuman. The struggle reminds me of the letter of a mortician who closed his letter with the words, "Eventually yours."
Wow.
Y'all don't get that.
Thank you.
All right. If you live a life of weakness and defeat, it is either because you are not hooked up with Christ or you don't know that you are in Christ. And so all of these things on page 1, I look at number 3. I mentioned the 4 greatest fears or problems of mankind are guilt, fear of death, fear of judgment, and the inability to feel comfortable in our approach to God. Now, this applies to Christians as well as non-Christians. Most people have a problem with guilt. And the message of righteousness is calculated to free you from that, from that stigma of feeling bad about yourself or feeling condemned. Now, if you studied the sufferings of Christ and all that he went through to release you from every work of Satan that has evolved in your life, now, I believe the price he paid was adequate to release you. And if you meditate on what Christ went through to release you from the law of sin and death, I believe that you will begin to look at the finished work of Christ in a new way, new life. The last 3 or 4 weeks, I just majored on Christ, what Christ went through and how effective his atonement was and how utterly Satan was defeated after seemingly hell and Satan and all of his courts had completely triumphed over Christ when he was going through that that period of spiritual suffering, being made sin for us. I mean, it was torture. I mean, it was beyond description. If you read Psalms 88 and Isaiah 53, what Christ went through and how he was in the throes of death, amen, for 3 days in the region of the dam, suffering to pay the price and to release us from every indictment that was leveled against us. That made, you know, it brought a freshness to my faith. And it made me more determined in my heart that Christ's suffering was not in vain. And it really brings you to the point where you know that, amen, your salvation, it was that travail, that the agony, the terror that he went through during that 3 days, amen, that was the thing that birthed our release from Satan. He suffered until he was what? Justified in the spirit, made alive. Amen. And when he was made alive, then the Bible says that he was delivered up for our defenses, but he rose again for our what? Justification. That means that Christ's victory becomes what? My victory. if all of the debt was completely settled, amen, that means that we are able to what? To be completely what? Free.
Yes.
Amen. The Bible says, Colossians 1, just look at that just for a second. We want to just kind of bring all of this into bear when we begin to talk about righteousness. Why are we able to say that righteousness is the ability to stand before God without a sense of unworthiness or guilt or inferiority or a sense of inability? When we really begin to look at that, and understand that we actually identify with Christ in every aspect of his redemptive work, then we can see very plainly why Satan can't come to us and what accuse us, because what? Jesus is the one that what justified us. He's the one that what died for us and paid the price and suffered and stayed there until what? Every debt was what? Settled. Amen. So, amen. Can't know, that's the reason the Bible says there is therefore what? Now, no what? Condemnation to them who are what?
Christ.
In Christ Jesus. Oh, that brought a freshness to my soul. I just focused on that so long until I can understand the scripture that I'm about to read now so plainly. Okay, Colossians 1. All right, I want you to look at that Colossians 1. Let's read the 20th verse. Everybody with me? And having made, well, let's look at verse 19. For it pleased the Father that in what? Him should what? All fullness what dwell. And having made peace through the blood of his cross, and him to reconcile all things unto himself, by him I say. Blood of the kings is there, all things in heaven. And you that were sometimes alienated and enemies in your mind by what words, yet now in the body of his flesh, through death to present you what? All right, if you continue in the faith, we have to bring that in too, because we have to, what, keep ourselves in the love of God in order for all of this to become, the righteousness to become, what, reality. Amen to us, amen, as we journey through life. There are certain things we have to do in order to have a consciousness that will be void of all sin, guilt, and inferiority. All right, so that is the reason why we can be bold and we can be comforted and we can be what, victorious. Because Christ was our substitute, right? He became sin for us, right? All right, when he met God's demands and he was quickened and made alive, then that was the life that we can tap in on. Of course, we have to receive salvation, but that was the thing that made it possible for us to receive eternal life. How many can say amen?
Amen.
Amen. Eternal, everybody just say eternal life.
Eternal life.
All right, the greatest need man had after his fall was what?
Eternal life.
Eternal life.
Eternal life.
Right? He couldn't receive eternal life until what? Until what? He had a what?
Substitute.
He had to have a mediator, right? All right? He had to have a mediator, and he had to become what? Righteous. Amen. So receiving eternal life, that means what? The righteousness was what? Restored. Amen. And who was the one that enabled him to experience the reconciliation? It was what? The mediator who was what?
Jesus.
Jesus. How many can appreciate you? How many understand the price he paid? Amen. Praise God. So, that's the reason why God has not given us the spirit of what? Fear, but of what? Power, love. Now look at all the fears that people have. Fear of death, fear of judgment. You think people are fear of judgment? You knock Brother Williams, knock on somebody's door in the community, and they think that you got a word from God, how do they respond?
They open it up.
All right, they open up, all right? Sometimes they look at you, what, strange. There's a certain fear that people have of God. Because they feel that, what, if they're not living right, then they're going to have to face, what, judgment. There's a fear of judgment. So those are fears that are real, but that's the reason why Jesus came to, what, release us from the power of fear. That was the reason why Jesus took part of what? He came in the flesh. So that through death, he might, what, destroy him who had the, what, power of death. And that is what? Now, all of those fears there, are they fears that people are contending with? Family, health alarms? All right, health alarms are people, okay, these are fears which plague mankind. Now, this is the reason why the message of righteousness has to be what? It has to what? It has to be, it has to prevail. And I believe it can. I believe it will. How many can say amen?
Amen.
Okay, family what? Instability, separation, divorces, infidelity, sexual fears, job insecurity, cutbacks, layoffs, declining economy, escalating cost of living, religious insecurity, miscellaneous fears, afraid of noises. Nobody afraid of noises around here. Afraid of sound. Afraid to go to sleep without a light on. It's where the rubber meets the road. Fear of flying. Fear of water. And many other phobias. These are things that people are contending with every day. So that shows that we need what to get the message of what righteousness over. I am afraid so. How many afraid people say, I'm afraid so? I'm afraid not. I haven't heard people talk like that. So-and-so-and-so-and-so-and-so. I'm afraid not. So-and-so-and-so-and-so. I'm afraid so. So what does righteousness mean? All right? That's what we're going to go on with you. I'm back next to Denise. Not tonight. You let me know. But next week, we're going to give all of these ways you can look at righteousness on page 27, 28. We're going to look at all of those. That's what we'll be on next week. And I'm going to get a grade out of how this is.
A grade?
I'm going to try to come up with some way where I can grade, get a grade from y'all's response on this part.
Just give us all an A.
All right. So, Sister Terry, you want to let us know if we are okay with our goals?
Most people have done, they told you verbally they need to pay on Sunday. Otherwise, they'll be paid.
All right. Okay, are there any other comments, explanations? All right. I think I will offer a maximum gift for people that read these confessions that deal with building the house type of thing, the maximum, the one that does it the most times within the next 3 weeks. There's a way I'm going to find out. All right.
Okay.
Yes, everybody standing there tonight. Thank you for coming. God bless you. Hallelujah. Thank you for your grace. Your grace is sufficient. You're able to cause all grace to abound toward us. So we will have sufficiency in everything. Father, you are the strength of our lives. You are the light of our salvation. We are complete in you. Every good and every perfect gift cometh from above. Yeah. From the Father's lights, with whom there's no verbalness, neither shall it upturn. Lord, you're able to cause all grace to abound toward us. So we will have sufficiency in everything. Our sufficiency is of you. We can do all things through Christ that strengthens us. Greater is he that is in us. Father, we thank you tonight.
as you are, so are we. Father, we thank you for the victory.
Thank you.
This is the victory. The Lord comes. Even our faith.
Yes, Lord.
Father, we're standing on your promises.
Yes.
All of your promises. All of your promises.
Yes,
Lord. Are yea and amen.
Amen.
This is the victory, Father, that overcomes even our faith.
Amen.
We thank you tonight, Lord.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. We thank you, God. If you who begun the good work within us, you will continue to perform it. Our eyes up on you. You the author and you the finisher of our faith. We give you praise and glory. We thank you for every gift and every giver. And we thank you, the Lord, and bless us as we leave this place. Bring us back at the appointed time. And we'll give you the praise and the glory in Jesus' name. Everybody say, in Jesus' name.
Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.